I'd like to explain some of the experiences I had as I got the book, how the Lord revealed his life to me. The Lord Jesus said to me, I'd like to show you some episodes of my life as I walk the Holy Land, because it will help benefit you and benefit others. And it's the most wonderful experience, because the Lord opened his life to me, and I was filled with grace to be able to see through his eyes at times. And that's why it was called Through the Eyes of Jesus, because I could see what the Lord was seeing. I could experience some of his emotions, some of his thoughts. At other times, I could see through the eyes of the apostles, watching Jesus, what he did, listening to what he said, and experiencing their emotions at the time. Other times, I was looking through the eyes of the people who were just there to be healed, or had come for prayers, or just to listen to the wonderful words of our Lord. So everything that's in the book is as I experienced it, as I happened, and at that time. And there was originally this 3 volumes, which is now into one book. And the book is so wonderful because what it does, it also opens up Jesus's humanity to us, so we can see how he felt, the emotions that he had at times, as he saw some terrible suffering, some wonderful joy, joyful things before him. And so in the book, you can come to experience these.
How beautiful is the love of Jesus. This story of the little boy nearly had me in tears. First of all, his love for his sick mother, where he is so willing to go out and look for this man, Jesus, who he doesn't even know, is so courageous. He believes so intently that this Jesus man is a good guy and that he can and he will heal his mother. We can learn a thing or two from this little boy, heart so full of trust, full of faith, no questions asked or concerns on how it would happen. He just believes that it will. He knows what he wants and he isn't afraid to ask for it. His mom is sick and he wants her to be healed. And he knows Jesus can do it. So he goes. Oh, I wish I had the faith like this little boy. So often I find myself asking Jesus questions of how it's going to happen or expressing my concerns to him. If only I could just believe that Jesus was a good guy and he was there to help, just like he was there for this little boy. I love the imagery of this little boy on Peter's shoulders, following Jesus. He doesn't even know them, but he knows that they are good. We too are called to be good. We are called to love one another as Jesus loves us. Do we love one another every single day? It doesn't matter who we are or where we come from. We are his sons. We are his daughters. What about the person at the coffee shop who can't decide what they want to order? Or the homeless person on the street who always asks you for money every time you walk by? What about the girl who just bothers you? Or that guy at youth group who took the last piece of pizza? Do you try to see Jesus in them? Jesus wants all of us to know of the Father's unconditional love. We can reflect this love to those around us, or not. It's up to us. Imagine if a little child came up to you asking you for help. They don't know you, but they see you, and they trust that you are good and can help them. Will you be Jesus to them? Jesus tells us that love is a great gift from God, a gift that can bring happiness and peace. How will you love today? Jesus, help me to see those around me through your eyes. Help me to always be good and to love as you have called me to love. Now we'll hear from Alan Ames as he shares his experience of seeing this story through the eyes of Jesus.
from the beginning, God has shown me love. He always has. And through this book, through the eyes of Jesus, we come to see and understand in a better way and experience more not only his divine love, but his human love, a love that he has for all people. And I'd like to share with you from a story that's called Unconditional Love. On the 12th of July, 1996. And it's a slightly longer story, but I'll share all of it with you because it's such a beautiful one. After eating, we made for the inn. As we approached, I could see my disciples encouraging the crowd to pray, but with little success. "Where's Jesus?" the people shouted. "We want Jesus," they cried. Someone saw Peter and I walked towards the crowd. "Here he is," he called, and the crowd rushed towards me. Soon, it was difficult to move with so many people around me. Then I could feel someone pulling at my coat. I stopped and turned to see a young boy who was trying to get my attention. He had made his way through the crowd and would not let go of me. "Peter," I said, "carry this boy." Peter picked the boy up and sat him on his shoulders. My disciples cleared a path for me to walk through. The crowd and Peter followed with the boy. I went to the front of the inn and gestured with my hands for them to sit and be quiet. It took some time, but eventually all were sitting and there was silence. I spoke loudly to them. "It's good to see you all here today, and soon I will pray with you all and talk to you. I ask, however, that first you pray together for a while, calling on the Father in heaven to answer your prayers." I turned and entered the inn with Peter and the boy. While outside, Simon was leading the people in prayer, and now they were following his words. I sat on a chair and called the boy to me. He was only about 6 or 7, with big wide eyes which looked at me in awe. He came to me and I asked of him, "What is it you want of me?" "With the truth that children have," he said, "my mother's ill and I cannot look after her. My mother sent me to you to ask for your help. I know your help because you're a good man. Will you help us, my child? Go home to your mother. She waits for you now and she is healed," I said, smiling at his innocence. "Thank you," he said. "I knew you'd help." "Son," said Peter, as he handed the boy some money, "here, take this coin with you. It may help." "Thank you too," said the child as he took the coin and looked into Peter's face. "You're a good man also," he said. Then he left, as if what had happened was to be expected. "Strange," said Peter. "He didn't ask any questions. He just accepted what you said. I wish all could trust in me like that. He came with the belief I would help him. He looked for goodness, found it, accepted it. The innocence of children, what a gift. A gift all have, but many lose." I returned to the crowd that was waiting patiently. Then I began to speak. "I see today many different people joined together seeking God's healing and God's word. Here today are Jews, Samaritans, Romans and Greeks. You sit here together in peace, together as brothers and sisters, together searching for the truth. This is how it should be at all times with all people, together in peace. Why is it then that when you leave here today, some of you will return to your ways of hating others who are different from you, while now you can sit with each other side by side with no concern for race or position? It is because you're opening your hearts to God and asking for God's healing. And with your hearts open to God, there is no place for hate within them. Can you not see? This is what God asks of you. To love one another regardless of who or what you are. To love one another as part of the same family, the family of God. Love is the healing power of God, for God is love. If you can try to love one another, then you will find the world beginning to be healed by the power of God's love. Today, if you're a Jew or a Roman or a Greek or a Samaritan, throw away those names. Say, "I am a child of God, and those around me are also children of God." then see you are one family and treat each other as you would your brother or your sister. Love is a great gift from God, a gift that brings happiness and peace. When I finished, many were crying and embracing those around them. I walked amongst them and began to hold them too. The love was so strong amongst these people. Now that I could feel their hearts glowing, this is the healing that all should seek, the true healing of the heart. Just then a woman came towards me with the boy who'd spoken to Peter and me before. "I've come to thank you, for I'm healed as you told my son I would be. Thank you, Jesus, thank you," she said as she kissed my hand. I looked at the boy who stared up at me and said, "I knew you would, you're a good man." I reached down and stroked his hair saying, "Be good for your mother and grow up to be a good man who loves God." "I'll be like you," he said, pointing at me with one finger. His mother said as she wiped the hair from his face, "Lord, he's a good boy and one day he'll be a good man." The crowd was then around us laughing and crying, full of God's love. I started to touch the sick and many were healed. As the day grew late, so I made my way with Peter to the inn and out the back way to return to the house where we were staying. When we reached there, I said to Peter, "Tomorrow I leave for a witch to spend some time with my father." "I will tell the others to be ready," said Peter. "But tell them we leave early," I said. I sat alone for a while as Peter returned to the inn to arrange our departure. When he came back, he said with a smile, "The owner of the inn will take no payment. He says it's a gift." "Thank you," he said. "The owner knows he's healed and he wants to thank you. And all the desires he had before, the desires of the flesh, they're all gone. Lord, you've done so much in this town. You have many friends here, even Romans. It's good so many have felt my father's love. One day all will know the depth of God's love. But unlike these people today, not all will accept it." Peter did not understand me, so I said, "One day in love, God will offer his heart to mankind. But not all will accept it. Many will reject it. Many will despise it. But in the end, God's love will overcome. And many will be changed to be filled with God's forgiveness." "Yes, Lord," said Peter, unsure. "One day, Peter, you'll know what I mean," I said, as I closed my eyes and thought of the future. You know, in those two great commandments, love God above all others and above all else, and love one another as I have loved you, there is the key to our faith. Many people say to me, how can I live my faith? Well, it's simple. We hear it so often in the readings in Scripture, love God and love one another. But it's very hard for us to do. To love God completely, to give ourselves completely to him. To love him more than others, more than self. To put him first in everything. Because this world brings us to focus on ourselves and to place ourselves first. To place our desires first, to place the world first, instead of placing God first, heavenly desires first. And so we can't love God as we should. We're called to give ourselves completely, all of ourselves to God in love, so we can be open to his love, because it's in that giving of self that we truly are open wide. When Jesus first came to me, and he said those three wonderful words to me, "I love you," I was filled with complete ecstasy, complete joy. I was laughing, I was crying for hours. It was amazing, because I'd never felt anything like it before. In those words, I knew was the truth, that God loved me. He always had and he always would. And in those words, I knew was the truth that God loved everyone exactly the same as he loved me. And as that love filled me, all my addictions and all my desire for sin, everything just disappeared, to be replaced with a desire to love God, to love him completely. And so every day, this is what I try to do now for 23 years. And in that loving God, as I open my heart to him, he shows me I have to love others, because it's impossible to love God completely unless you love others as you should. You know, Jesus is there each day beside each one of us, crying out to us in love, crying out, I love you. He has a passionate love for each person. He aches with love for us. To him, each one of us is a treasure. We're precious, we're a jewel. Jesus is actually in love with us. And just like when you're in love with someone, you want them to have a good, a successful, a happy life. So it is with Jesus, who's in love with us. He wants us to have a good, a happy, a successful life. And just like you will do all you can to help those you love, Jesus will do all he can to help us. He'll give us all he can to help us have that good, that holy, that happy life. But we have to want that. We have to accept the love of Jesus within. Now, Jesus loves us in this way, and he cries out in each moment that he loves us, but he also cries out, he implores us, he begs us to love him. He cries out, I love you, love me. Now, he wants our love, not because it will make him any greater, that's impossible. God is great in himself, but because it will make us greater. Because when we love God as we should, above all others, above all else, above even self, then our hearts, our souls are open wide to God. There's no barriers now between us and God. And then the Lord can reach deep inside of us to fill us with the graces, the gifts, the love we need. He can then elevate us, he can sanctify us, he can raise us heavenward to the Father in love. He wants to make us greater in his love. He wants us to be greater people, to be holy people, to be sacred people that we were created to be. And today many people, they find it hard to love as Jesus calls us to. You know, he said, love one another as I have loved you. And he calls us beyond human love. He calls us to divine love, to love the way he loves, with a love for everyone, unconditional love, tender love, gentle love, merciful, forgiving love. To love those who would hurt you. But today, for us, that's very hard for many people to do. It's so easy not to love. And part of the reason is because we do not seek to have that divine love of Christ that we're called to have. We have an emotional love. And when you have an emotional love, that can change very easily, because your emotions change through life. You know, maybe your hormones, at times in our lives, our hormones change. They affect our emotions. Maybe the stress of living or problems at work and finances, things like that. They can all affect your emotions and they can affect your love. I've seen some people so in love one minute, the next minute they hate each other. And that's because their love is emotional and it can change, it can be broken. But when you have the love that Jesus calls us to, the divine love that Christ has, the spiritual love, then your love can never be broken. Doesn't matter how much people hurt you, no matter how much people abuse you, make fun of you, how badly they treat you, that your love will never be broken, because you'll see that that's what they did to Jesus. They made fun of him, they abused him, they treated him badly. He never stopped loving. And when you love in the way of Jesus, you'll never stop loving. And if you know, in a marriage and a family, there's always tensions and difficulties that go on, and love can easily at times be broken. But if you hold on to Jesus' love in that marriage, if you try to love as Jesus loves and put Jesus at the head of the marriage, making a trinity of love, with Jesus at the head of the marriage in love, husband and the wife, in love making up the trinity of love, loving Jesus first and then loving each other. That's what it's meant to be in a marriage. The love in a marriage is meant to be one in the love of Jesus and a reflection of the divine love of Christ. And in his love, Jesus served. And so the husband must serve the wife, and the wife should serve the husband. But so often, marriages break because the husband maybe wants the wife to serve him. And he thinks that he's the master. Or the other way around, the wife wants the husband to serve her, and she's more important. And when that happens, marriages can easily be broken. But when the husband serves the wife and the wife serves the husband in love, then their love is strengthened because now they're loving in the way that Jesus loves. And when they invite Jesus into the marriage to make that Trinitarian love, that love will be so strong it will never be broken. The problem today is that our love is so often just emotional, and we need to live a life of love that is love of the way of Jesus, the spiritual love. For that to happen, we can't do it by ourselves, it's impossible. We have to ask the Holy Spirit to help us to love in the way of Christ. And so every day that's what I do. I ask him to help me love as Jesus loves, and I still struggle with it at times, but he helps me to love better than I ever did before. And when you ask the Holy Spirit to help you love in that spiritual way and persevere, you'll find one day he'll be reaching deep inside of you to set fire to your soul with a flame of love that will burn so brightly. And the more you ask, the brighter and brighter that flame will grow. And as that gets brighter and brighter, what will happen is your love for God will grow and grow, your ache, your hunger, your thirst for his love. And your love for others will grow because you'll see them now for what they are, an image of God, a creation of God's love, your brothers and sisters of love, a family of love in God who is love. And so you'll want to love them, to care for them. And no matter what people do to you, you'll never turn away from them. You'll love them unconditionally because you know this is the way that Christ loved. And yeah, that's hard. It's hard at times. But you can find the strength to love in that way by coming to the sacrament of love, the Holy Mass, the Eucharist. Because it's here you can receive the Lord of love, Jesus Christ. When you come to communion in the way of love, truly reaching out and seeking Jesus, opening your heart to Jesus, crying out in the Holy Mass, Lord, I love you. Fill me completely with your love. You know, when you begin the Mass and you say in the name of the Father, you should be looking to the Father in heaven in love, crying out, I love you, Father. And the Son saying, Father, let me be filled with your Son of love, Jesus, by the grace of your Holy Spirit. And when you do that, the Holy Spirit will then draw you into the Mass so you can be completely open to receive Jesus in the way you should, the way of love. And then when you come to communion and receive Jesus within, there'll be an explosion within you as you eat of his body and drink of his blood. When you're completely open to him in love, putting self and the world aside, removing the barriers of pride, exposing yourself completely to him, opening your heart, your very soul to Jesus, crying out in love, begging him to fill you completely with his divine being. When you receive him in that way, then there'll be an explosion within you. That flame of love will burn so brightly because his body, his blood, that is the food for that fire of love. That is the food that makes it grow because he is love. And so when you receive him in that way, then that flame will burn stronger and stronger. It'll burn so brightly that every time people look at you, they'll see Jesus in you. They'll see his love in you. They'll feel his love through you. And this is what's meant to happen in the Holy Mass. You're meant to become vessels of God's love. You're meant to be that flame of love that goes out into the darkness in the world to disperse that darkness by the power, grace and love of our divine Lord God and Saviour within you, who's burning so brightly within you and reaching out through you. You're meant to go out into the world as vessels of love to the lost, to the lonely, to the unloved, to the most terrible people doing the most terrible things. You're meant to go out to them in love and reach out to them in love so that then through you, Jesus can reach out through you to touch them with his love, to bring them to him. And you'll lose your fear of doing that because when he's burning so brightly within you in this way, your fear disappears because now you know when you leave the church with Jesus within you, every step you take, he's taking with you. Every good thought you're having, he's having with you. Every good word you're speaking, he's speaking through you. And every time you reach out to someone in love, he's reaching out through you, with you, and in you to touch that person, to bless that person, and to fill them with his love. This is what he calls us to be. He calls us to be his apostles of love. He calls us to love in the way he loves. Love one another as I have loved you. He calls us to love in the divine way, in the way of God. Not in the worldly way, in the human way, which so often is emotional, is a shallow love, is a love that's focused on self and on the world and not on God and others. Jesus calls us beyond that to be the true vessels of love we were created to be. The image of God, God who is love, and we're meant to be an image of that love, that unconditional love, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord.
I'm Bishop Eugene Hurley from the Diocese of Darwin, which takes in the whole of the Northern Territory of Australia. And I'm delighted that Shalom Ministry is now in a position to bring some of that good news to the rest of Australia and indeed to the world. Because we live in a world where the media is so influential, it dictates so much of our learning and our attitudes. And so it's so important that the good news of Jesus Christ has to be made available to all people, because it's what we each need as human beings to enliven us, to make us more loving, and indeed to bring about peace in the world. So it's this good news that the Shalom Ministry is trying to get across to Australia now. Let me invoke God's blessing upon Shalom Ministry and all who work within it and all who are the subject of its good work. May the blessed Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon the Shalom Ministry and all who work in it and all their families. May keep them at peace forever. Amen.
Shalom World, God's own channel.